This is Natasha Sachdev for the Quint, and I'm here with Prashant Bhushan, sir, who is obviously one of the most well-known lawyers in India and an eminent activist when it comes to the corruption space. Mr. Bhushan is well-known to everyone, obviously, as is his father, Shanti Bhushan, former law minister, who crucially was the man who fought against Indira Gandhi in a massive election case way back in the 70s, which unfortunately ended up precipitating the emergency, but was crucial for showing that we can stand up for our rights and that our courts and our constitution can help us do that. And that is in fact the subject of this book, Case That Shook India, written by Mr. Bhushan back in the 70s and republished recently by Penguin. Mr. Bhushan, obviously at the time when you wrote the book, it was new, it was important, it was big events going on at that time. So what were your motivations behind, did you have anything specific behind why you wanted to write this book at the time and why you felt that it was important?
No, I just happened to have an inside view of the court proceedings. Essentially because my father was the counsel for Raj Narain in this case. And I felt that it was an important case, both from the point of view of legal and constitutional history of this country, as well as because of its political ramifications. And therefore, I felt that I might as well write about it. Of course, the initial draft of the book was written in early 76,
right,
soon after the case ended in the Supreme Court in November 75.
Yeah.
But it could get published only after the emergency ended in 77.
Sure. So for those who aren't aware at the time, before the emergency, there was an attempt by Raj Narain, who was Indira Gandhi's opponent in the Raebareli constituency, to unseat her from her and cause her to be disqualified from her election in the 1970 general elections for corrupt practices. And this was an incredibly controversial case. It involved looking at things like expenses being used and utilizing government officials by the Prime Minister to try and get herself elected. Now, Mr. Bhushan, obviously this was back in, the book was originally published in, as you said, 78,
77
and it's been a long time obviously since then. So why republish it at this time?
It's been out of print for more than 35 years, and during this time, especially in the last several years, several people have been asking me for copies of the book, mostly law students and lawyers, and a lot of people, since I didn't have any copies to give them, I could only get photocopies made. So there were many people asked me, why don't you get it republished?
Mm-hmm.
And recently, when one of my junior colleagues, Siddharth Garg, said that he would undertake the responsibility of getting it republished, and he approached Penguin and they eagerly accepted, then we decided to have it republished, because there is still a lot of continuing interest in this case for obvious reasons.
So I've actually been doing a book review of this book for the Quint, and I have to say it's an incredibly interesting piece for a number of reasons, because as a lawyer I have read the Supreme Court judgment, we've studied it in class, but what we don't go into is the sort of details which, for instance, the High Court decision went into, which was where Mrs. Gandhi was actually disqualified and then had to be saved by the Supreme Court in a sense. And I found it was these little details which made it quite so fascinating. We recently at the Quint were talking about also how the fact that court proceedings, there's no transcript, there's no transparency, all you get is a final judgment, we don't get to see the actual arguments before the court. And this obviously is incredible because you were there in the courtroom at the time when this was happening. So how was your experience of trying to sort of keep this, these running notes of what was happening? And did you feel that this was a job which was very difficult to do? Or do you think the journalists need to do this better? Or do you think there's a need for reform at this point in the courts?
general, I have always felt that there need to be video recordings of court proceedings, which today is very easy given the kind of technology that we have, which will give us an accurate record of all court proceedings. Most journalists don't record questions from judges, answers by counsel, etc., because it's not so important and there isn't that much interest in so much detail about the case. But this was one case because of its constitutional importance as well as political importance, where I felt that there would be that kind of interest. It's not difficult to keep these notes. Some of these good court reporters do maintain such notes of questions and answers from judges. They don't write about it in such detail because the newspapers don't have that much space, because papers feel that there isn't that much interest in so much detail. But it's not difficult to keep notes, though it would be much better for there to be video recordings.
Because, for instance, one of the really interesting things is in the appendices, you've added the testimony of Mrs. Gandhi, which I thought was absolutely fascinating to go through, because again, we don't get this. You'll only see the excerpts will come in the judgment. And so in terms of how to try and make this whole process more transparent, give the public more, especially where the government is involved, is in a case like this. We recently saw with the Aadhaar judgment, there were some lawyers in the court who were trying to live tweet what was going on. Do you approve of this kind of thing where lawyers are being able to tweet from inside the courtroom what arguments are being raised and what's being done?
I don't see anything wrong with that. I don't see any harm, so long as it is done accurately.
Right.
And therefore, people should be accurate in what they do. Of course, I must say that in this case, while the case was going on in the Allahabad High Court, there were some good court reporters in Allahabad who were reporting the arguments in great detail, the questions and answers, etc. But when it came to the Supreme Court, the
censorship
emergency was in force and press censorship was there, and therefore the arguments were not being reported by any newspaper. So probably my notes were the only record of the arguments in that case. Actually, I had also maintained similar notes of that 1.5 day aborted review of case 1 and the Bharati,
which
is there in the appendix.
Case.
Yeah, as well as the habeas corpus case, the ADM Jabalpur case. But unfortunately, I tried to dig out those notes and I can't locate them. It's a great pity.
That would have been quite fascinating. To just sort of go back to the case and what it means today, because nowadays everyone seems to just think it's normal for people, for politicians to be spending crazy amounts of money, corruption. Everyone is. It's, I mean, we don't like it, but it's, you know, nobody seems to think that there's a way to deal with it. So when your father took up the case at that time, like. I know you made some comments about this in the book as well, about what he was hoping to achieve out of it. But I mean, how do you think lawyers today should try to approach a case of this, where say they know that they may be find it difficult to win, but they think it's important to take up? How do you think lawyers should be trying to take these kind of activist stances and trying to make sort of a change in these circumstances? Or
since I do mostly public interest litigation. My own view has always been that lawyers need to be conscious of what is happening in society and need to be activists of some kind. But unfortunately, very few lawyers even look at the kind of cases that they take up or whether there is justice on the side of their clients. And many lawyers don't even follow ethical practices while handling cases.
So
election petitions actually are one class of petitions which are rarely decided before they become infructuous, because within 5 years fresh elections are to be held.
Yeah.
And very few, though the law says, constitution says, the Representation of People's Act says, that election petitions should be decided within 6 months. but hardly any election petition is ever decided in 6 months, and very few election petitions are decided within 5 years.
Right.
With the result that most of them have become infructuous. And that is why transgressions of election law, corrupt practices, etc., are not taken seriously, because most people feel that they will not be held accountable because the cases filed by their opponents are not going to be decided in time. Even Mrs. Gandhi's case
right.
initially went quite slowly. It's only after Justice Sinha took over as the judge handling the case that he speeded it up and brought it to a conclusion within 6 months of having taken it up.
Yeah. That was in 74 and he took it up?
Sometime towards the end of 74. So, even that case took almost 4 years
right.
for it to be decided. So, normally election petitions are to be decided within
swiftly
6 months.
It would, yeah. would be the Pope. I think one of the important things is, you know, when it comes to a lot of these things about the law, a case like this, or trying to understand legislation like this, it's quite difficult for often for lay people who don't have an understanding or study of the law to understand this. One of the things which I found very, very incredible about the book was how easy it was, how you tried to break down very complex and technical arguments into an easier process. And for someone who's trying to do more of this kind of writing in the space, it's something I struggle with. So how is it that do you have any pointers about how lawyers can try and help make things easier for, you know, trying explaining complex things in which are important for people to know to the general public?
So law is meant for the people. The Constitution and the law are all meant for the people, and there is no point in having a constitution and law which people can't understand. Unfortunately, you see, there is a tendency amongst some lawyers and some judges to unnecessarily clothe everything that they are saying in legalese, use Latin phrases, and so on and so forth, and thereby obfuscate what they are saying for the common people. When I wrote this book, I was an undergraduate student.
Right.
Therefore, I had not studied law when I was writing this book. Therefore, I was looking at it from a layman's point of view. And of course, there was a lot of law in my family. My father, grandfather, etc. were all lawyers. I could perhaps understand a little more law than many other lay people could. But still, my own effort in writing has always been to write in as simple a language and try and put across things in a manner which ordinary lay people can understand, which is how things should be.
Right. Because, we look at... And that's an incredible observation, because some of the arguments, as I mentioned, are so technical. So do you think that, you know, if that journalists, if they work, can actually try and make this easier for people who are not actually lawyers to understand these kind of things? Because the arguments were incredibly difficult, and yet you, despite not being a lawyer at the time, you were able to frame them very easily. Was that something where your father helped you with that, or were you able to just...
No, my father did not even read the book until after it was written.
Okay.
And in fact, he perhaps read only one chapter before it was published.
Right.
there are some good court journalists who do write in a manner which ordinary people can understand, because they are writing for newspapers. They are not writing for legal journals, etc.
Right.
So the good court journalists writing for newspapers do write in a manner which ordinary lay people can understand, and any reasonably intelligent person can do that. It's not so difficult.
So one of the things that you mentioned in the preface to the book is the fact that there have been now new changes under the Finance Act 2017. Which are making it more difficult for to actually get any information about the funding given to political parties. There's no longer a limit on the amount of money a company can donate to a political party. You can now buy electoral bonds, which are anonymous. When you're looking at the state of the corruption in politics now, and when you're looking at versus then, how do you think these kind of challenges can now be tackled? Because even the legacy of that case was where the government was making retrospective amendments left, right, and center to make their old illegal acts legal. How do we try to combat this today in the courts, something like, for instance, the changes in the Finance Act? And is there a possibility to actually contest these things and try and hold our political parties and organizations more accountable?
See, unfortunately, elections today in this country are won or lost to a very large extent on the basis of the amount of money that the candidates have access to. Because people, when they vote not merely for the candidate whom they consider best. They also vote on the basis of which candidates they see as having a winning chance. So nobody wants to waste his vote and vote for an excellent candidate who has no chance of winning. And this being able to see who are the candidates who have a winning chance is largely a function of the visibility of those candidates. And visibility is normally purchased by money, by a lot of advertising, by having a lot of paid workers on the ground, by organizing large rallies which are also paid for and where people are often brought by paying money, etc. So therefore, money plays a very important role in elections in our democracy. And that is why this law was brought, limiting the amount of expenses that any candidate could spend on an election. Earlier, in Mrs. Gandhi's time, it was 35,000, now it's about 40 lakhs or something like that. But unfortunately, all these rules are still broken. And recently, there have been some very retrograde changes made in the law relating to funding of political parties. Last year, in the Finance Act, after the Delhi High Court had held the Congress and the BJP guilty of accepting foreign funds in violation of the Foreign Contribution Regulation Act, they brought a retrospective amendment to the FCRA saying that political parties could take donations from subsidiaries of foreign companies, which essentially means from foreign corporations. This year, two further retrograde amendments have been brought through the Finance Act. One, the limit on corporate funding of political parties, which was earlier 7.5% of their annual profits, has been removed. So now corporations can give any amount of donations to political parties, even foreign corporations, that is subsidiaries of foreign corporations, because of the amendment last year. And they can do so anonymously by this new device of electoral bonds that has been introduced. So earlier there was this problem of lack of transparency in political funding because cash donations up to 20,000 did not need to be declared. So political parties were taking hundreds of crores by way of cash donations by just saying that these are all petty donations without disclosing who are the donors. This time that 20,000 limit has been reduced to 2,000, but that makes no difference. Political parties can still say that we receive 90% of our funds in petty cash donations of under 2,000. So, unfortunately, most political parties get together, most major political parties come together for making these retrograde changes in election laws because it suits all the mainstream major political parties to increase the role of money power in elections because they know that they will have money. The other smaller parties or independents will not have money. To also give other kinds of advantages to ruling parties or to major political parties and deny the same to other smaller parties and individuals. And that is what has happened.
Right. And do you think there's any way to actually try and challenge this kind of these developments in politics? Because we all look at it, we get upset about it, but is there anything we can actually do? Like Raj Narain, with your father's help, was able to try and take it to court at least. Is there something we can do about
Yes, yes. In fact, we have prepared a petition. In fact, two petitions. One is regarding this leeway given to accepting cash without disclosing who are the donors.
Yeah.
And the other is this new changes that have been brought by way of removing the cap on corporate funding, by making donations anonymous, by allowing foreign funding, etc. All these are going to be challenged very shortly by Common Cause as well as Association for Democratic Reforms.
Yeah.
If you remember, the first direction for any kind of transparency in the donations received by political parties also came as a result of a Common Cause petition and an order of the Supreme Court, when they ordered that political parties must file income tax returns. Right. And therefore, these income tax returns are now disclosed to the Election Commission, through whom organizations like ADR, Association for Democratic Reforms, are able to access them under RTI and thereby place them in the public domain. Unfortunately, despite an order of the Central Information Commission saying that political parties must come under RTI because they are public authorities, political parties have not brought themselves under RTI so far.
So, start wrapping up, I'm looking at the fact that obviously here one of the legacies of the emergency was that the Supreme Court, many feel, didn't play the role it should have at that time in trying to protect democracy. Do you believe that the Supreme Court of today, if faced with similar challenges, would be able to take the right decisions and stand up to a politician like Mrs. Gandhi, who is trying to get around it using methods like she did?
Well, in Mrs. Gandhi's case, an emergency had been imposed. When the case came up to the Supreme Court and retrospective changes in the election laws had been made, and it was because of that and the fear due to the emergency in the minds of judges, which was evident in the habeas corpus case, that ADM Jabalpur case as well.
Justice Bhagwati, of all people.
Yes, he also mentioned that later. It was, I feel, because of that they allowed the retrospective changes in the election laws to remain in place without striking them down. And it was on those retrospective changes that Mrs. Gandhi's election was upheld by the Supreme Court. But having said that, you see, unseating a sitting prime minister or ordering criminal investigation against a sitting prime minister, especially against a powerful sitting prime minister, is always a tough call for a judge. It requires a judge who is independent as well as robust and bold. Unfortunately, most judges in the country would fail that test. And that is what we saw, though Justice Sinha passed that test in the Allahabad High Court. But many other judges, even at that time, would have failed that test even prior to the emergency. Of course, the emergency brought a different dimension to the situation at that time. But we have seen that same failure in the Birla Sahara Diaries case in the Supreme Court. It was clearly a case crying out for a criminal investigation where the Income Tax Department had recovered documents from both the Birla and Sahara companies, which showed bribery as well as payment of huge amounts of black money to various politicians, particularly the Prime Minister, Mr. Modi, 40 crores in the case of Sahara, 25 crores in the case of Birla, But all that went uninvestigated, despite the Income Tax Department preparing detailed appraisal reports saying
right.
that these documents show the true state of affairs.
Yeah. And you feel that that is something where the court should have taken a...
Yes, that's also a case of failure of justice on account of this getting overawed by the fact that there is a Prime Minister on the other side who will have to be investigated, and a powerful Prime Minister at that.
This has been incredibly, it's been incredibly fascinating being able to have this discussion with the institution, and I think what we've looked at here in terms of what we've discussed is something which I think would be helpful for many other lawyers to also think about these kind of things, and for people who are not practicing lawyers or to understand how what are the main issues which we're facing in terms of political corruption and where we can try and work just to work against it. Now, for instance, the fact that you mentioned the ADR case, the Association for Democratic Reforms, is filing a case, and we hope that obviously there will be some progress in that matter, and we would look that works out. Would it be okay for you to sign this copy of the book
sure,
for us?
Sure.
Who should I address it to? To the Quint would be there.